coronavirus pandemic, Asian Americans rose to answer the call as frontliners, caregivers, cure seekers, truth tellers, providers, and modern day heroes. We can't say enough about how grateful and proud we are of you and the work you do.
Okay, welcome everybody to our workshop, Story Power and Engaging the AAPI Electorate. This is a co-sponsored workshop with ADOC, the Asian American Documentary Network. So my name is Grace Lee, and I'm a filmmaker based in Los Angeles. I've been making films for many years, which include American Revolutionary, The Evolution of Grace Lee Boggs, as well as two episodes of the recent Asian Americans PBS series. And after this panel, you can tune into PBS POV and watch my new two-part series, And She Could Be Next, which is about a defiant movement of women of color transforming politics. I'm also one of the co-founders of ADOC, the Asian American Documentary Network, as are all of our amazing panelists right here. Real quickly, I'm going to introduce ADOC, and then I'm going to introduce the panelists and get into it. So ADOC is a national network of around 600 so far Asian Americans working in nonfiction storytelling. We're mostly independent filmmakers, but also include organizers, curators, writers, academics amongst us. We exist to uplift, mentor, advocate, and share resources for our community, including internal and external programming at film festivals, conferences, and panels like this. We invite everyone to find out more about our more about us at our website, which is a-doc.org. And you can also find a member database there, as well as films featuring Asian American content by Asian American filmmakers. So let me introduce some of the most exciting members of ADOC with us today on the panel. After we get things started, we have Yi Chen, who is a Washington, D.C. based filmmaker and recipient of the Soros Equality and D.C. Arts and Humanities Fellowships. Her previous film, Chinatown, documents the fight for affordable housing for low-income seniors. And today, she and Carolyn Chen will discuss Yi's new feature documentary, First Vote, which looks at both sides of the political divide in election battleground states. And Carolyn Chen is a legislative analyst for the Montgomery County Council in Maryland and a member of its racial equity and social justice legislative team. She has a wide-ranging background in management consulting, philanthropy, and fundraising in the healthcare, education, and nonprofit sectors. Next, we're going to hear from Seth Hernandez Ronquillo, Philippines-born undocumented immigrant filmmaker and community organizer and co-founder of the Undocumented Filmmakers Collective. They are the recipient of the Disruptors, Firelight Impact Producer, and the Soros Justice Fellowships. Seth will discuss their film coverage about the healthcare justice movement for undocumented immigrants. And then finally, we will have KV Vu. She's a Vietnamese-American videographer and content creator based in Atlanta. She co-founded Wake Up Atlanta, a web series that works to increase AAPI civic engagement in Georgia. For that project, she was recognized as an Asian Americans Advancing Justice Atlanta's 2019 Rising Star. So we're really excited to be here at the summit because as ADOC members, we believe storytelling truly is a pathway to creating social change and one of the strongest ways to advocate for our communities. This is something I've been attempting to do for my entire filmmaking career, and She Could Be Next, my current series, provides a kind of backdrop to the panel discussion today. So I think just without further ado, let's just watch the trailer and get it started.
In the history of this country, any guesses out of 11,000 people that have served in the United States Congress, how many women of color have served?
There is this assumption that Black people don't vote, that Latinos are not American citizens, that Asian Americans are Republicans, and that young people are wholly unreliable.
I want you to understand that who I am is a product of a movement.
There are not enough people on the inside that look like me.
People aspiring to be leaders in this country, they need to go through women of color because we're making our voices known.
Es un honor estar aquí. when I say I'm a social justice seeker, I'm a mama for justice or all these things, that's where I'm saying I'm American. I don't need to say it. I act like an American.
Candidates do not normally talk to people in the Asian American community because, historically speaking, we are the community that turns out to vote at the lowest rates. So we want to change that here today.
We're no longer asking for permission to do what we need to do. We're going to do it, and we're going to lead from the top, and people need to see it.
The sort of traditional notions of what's possible in American politics are being challenged every day.
Elections are important, but our lives are on the line. Elections are
and brothers, it's about building power in our community to win what is right.
Except the communities that need to be brought in reflect the new American majority. They're young, they're brown, they might speak another language.
And there's a lot of us.
I'm excited about the fact that women of color are now coming into our own, that we're standing up and taking our rightful place in the pantheon of leadership, that we're changing what the face of leadership looks like.
It is a new day, there's a new coalition, and ultimately we're gonna push this country forward because there's more of us than those that seek to do us harm.
Okay, so that's And She Could Be Next, airing now on PBS. One of the central ideas of the series that we created is that there is an organizer in all of us and we need to step into our power and find a political home. So this idea that there's an organizer in all of us is why it was really important for us to focus not just on candidates and elections, but people who've been doing the grassroots work in community on a year-round basis. And I think everyone on the panel here is going to talk about how they're doing that, either as organizers themselves or documenting people who are doing that, and how people are participating civically, no matter, you know, what your background is or what your status is. Much of the film of And She Could Be Next takes place in Georgia. I think KB will have a lot to say about that. Where we follow a coalition of organizers, Black, Latinx, Asian American, who are showing what it means to lead a civic life. I just wanna show another short clip that includes some of the Asian Americans who are organizing to get Stacey Abrams elected to governor in 2018. I think it's important for many of us to actually show people like us organizing, show people like us getting involved, not just running for office, but also behind the scenes, because I think for so many of us, you know, seeing is actually understanding that we actually exist. So why don't we show this short clip? Clip number two.
Okay. 다음 주 화요일인데 내일도 투표하실 수 있어요. 만약에 아침 7시에 투표 장소에 가실 수 있으면은 아침 7시부터 투표하실 수 있어요.
Do you see like a Vietnamese name? I got you.
Frankly speaking, I don't think any one of our populations could win the election alone. And we all realize that, which is why, you know, we've been working closely with Gente. And that's also why we say over and over again that our campaign isn't just about Stacey Abrams. It's about building relationships between our communities. It's about building power, long-term power, for a collectively sourced vision.
I think that for me, this is very personal because within the Filipino community, there are a lot of people who are who are really against the plight of undocumented immigrants. And myself, as an undocumented immigrant, as a DACA recipient who grew up here in the United States, I take it very personally when people in my community, the Filipino American community, say that all, quote, illegals have to go back, and that all, quote, illegals don't pay their taxes and they're sucking off of our American economy. And whenever I get that at the door, I always try and encourage people to understand their history and their heritage.
Great. So, you know, I just wanted to show these clips to just sort of set the stage for the discussion today, and happy to answer questions about it later. But for now, I want to turn it over to Yi-Chen.
Thank you, Grace. First of all, I want to thank APIAVote and ADOC for having me on the panel. So as Grace introduced, my film First Vote is released this year. And I'm going to talk more about the film and how the film can support AAPI organizations' civic engagement work from my perspective as a filmmaker, and also Caroline, she'll talk about it from an organizational perspective. So for those who haven't seen the film, I would like to start off by showing you a very short a clip from the film.
Vote is a privilege. Not everybody gets to vote in the world.
Hey, how are you? Would you like a voter guy?
Thank you.
In the way that our electoral system works, we have choices. Our choices have absolute consequences.
The message coming out of Ohio in 2018, and that is the blueprint for America for 2020.
Our diversity is our strength, but our unity is our power. Newcomers to America make America more American.
And I also have a slide, if we can play that. So I started the project in after the 2016 elections, after seeing how the 2016 election has divided the AAPI community. So the film is about, can we go to the next slide? Great, thank you. So the film features, it's a 1 hour long documentary that features four Chinese American voters from both sides, two Republicans and two Democratic voters. And the film follows them from 2016 to the 2018 midterm elections in two battleground states, North Carolina and Ohio. And the film explores the issues of immigration, voting rights, and racial justice. Next slide, thank you. So just a little brief introduction to the four characters. So Jennifer Hull, she was a professor teaching critical race theory and Asian American studies at UNC Chapel Hill. She's now moved to University of Colorado Boulder in the ethnic studies department. Kaiser Guo, he is the host of the Seneca podcast. He lived in Beijing for 20 years and moved back to the US in 2016. He's a Democrat, and he was shocked by the rise of the Chinese Tea Party and wrote an article about it, which alienated his wife's conservative Chinese immigrant friends. And then Sue Guj, she was a first-time voter in 2016. And she also ran as a Republican for North Carolina's District 4 congressional seat, but she lost to David Price. And Lance Chen, he is a professor at University of Dayton. So he's based in Dayton, Ohio. He was also a first-time voter in 2016, and he co-founded the Asian American Republican Coalition PAC, which donated to Republican candidates. And he also has a conservative Mandarin language podcast. So due to the pandemic, we have shifted our focus to digital strategy and online audience engagement. The film premiered last month and has screened at 4 virtual festivals in LA, San Francisco, Houston, and DC. Can we go to the next slide, please? Thanks. So our next screening is July 9th through 12th at the Ann Arbor, Michigan-based Nevertheless Film Festival. And we will be donating a portion of the ticket sales to APIAVote Michigan. We're also working with outreach partners to organize community screenings to engage AAPI voters leading up to November 2020. We'll start with the OCA screening at the OCA National Summit on July 30th. Next slide, please. So these are just some of the statistics I'm sure most of you are already familiar with, to kind of set the context for what we want to do for our impact campaign. So in 2020, AAPI voters will reach about estimated 11 million voters in 2020. For the impact campaign, we also So the film offers a timely understanding of the diversity among the AAPI electorate ahead of November 2020, and also barriers facing AAPI voters that have produced a racial disparity in voter turnout. I think in Grace's trailer that I think Raymond also, or someone mentioned in the trailer that AAPI has the lowest voter turnout, which in 2016, it was 15% lower than the 64% of white voter turnout. So our goal with the impact campaign, next slide please. So our goal with the impact campaign is to highlight the importance of US voter participation and explore the ability of underrepresented AAPI electorate to engage equitably in the US democratic process. Working with outreach partners, our primary goal is to educate through the examination of complex systemic challenges, change minds and behaviors, and empower AAPI voters to participate in American democracy, to register and vote in 2020. So as a filmmaker, I believe that, film itself doesn't create change, but it's people who create change. So we're working with outreach partners to bring the film to AAPI communities. And here are some of the resources. On our website, you can see our future screenings. So watch the film. And then you can connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at First Vote Film. We also have a resource page that has a lot of resources on voting and also on anti-racism. So definitely read and share our resources. And also, I can't see the audience there, but I hope you'll become our outreach partner. And we have digital toolkit you can request a screening, host a screening through our website, firstvotefilm.com. And we have digital toolkits that would help you with community screenings. So the last slide is our next screening at Nevertheless Film Festival. So I'm gonna hand it off to Carolyn. So I'm working with her to organize screenings for Montgomery County Council and residents. So I'll let her talk about how she's going to do that.
Hi, everybody. I'm Carolyn, Carolyn Chen. I am a legislative analyst with the Montgomery County Council in Maryland. I know this is nationwide, so hopefully some of you know where we're talking, but it's a local county jurisdiction. So the examples that I'm talking with Yi about on using her film are very, very timely and specific. I submitted a community screening request through her link after I actually viewed Yi's and Grace's film at AFI Docs. And I immediately thought that it was a perfect medium to match what the county is doing on a jurisdictional level in relation to our racial equity and social justice legislation that was passed last year and that is now being ramped up this year. And what is really unique about especially Yi's film is the perspective of Chinese Americans that are immigrants that vote for different reasons and from both sides of the party lines. It breaks a lot of stereotypes. And the first thing I said to Yi was, your presence as a filmmaker and the type of point of view that you bring on shows the next generation of Asian Americans that will eventually lead. And I say eventually because in the last 30 years, it's still the same people in government that are leading. So it's important to at least have the easy access interest. Anyone can watch a film. Anyone can discuss a film. Anybody can have an opinion about a film. So it's a very easy door to be able to bring something completely new. And a great documentary allows you to be immersed in a completely different environment. So not only is it something that I will be using to expose county level employees on Asian American voters and how that plays out in our own jurisdiction, but also the many Asian organizations that we give we provide social services to on a county level in order to use that to galvanize for voting. We already do it for census. And census is very multicultural and there hasn't been the same type of effort in terms of registering to vote that's specific to hard to reach communities. So I encourage everybody to organize community screenings and continue breaking stereotypes and highlighting the next generation of Asian American leaders.
Hey, if you want to hand it off to Set.
Oh, sorry. Hand off to Set. Sorry. Popcorn, whatever. Set, you're next.
Thank you, Ian and Carolyn, for the work that you're doing. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me in this panel. Super honored to be in the presence of these amazing, powerful women and filmmakers. I'm going to share my screen to share a little bit about the work that we're doing. As Grace said, you know, I'm an undocumented filmmaker, and I know this event is called APIAVote, and I am 28 now, and I have never voted because I can't vote. And I think for me, what I want to share is kind of the perspective of how we build power beyond the electoral landscape and being able to really show the dynamic power of people who are immigrants who cannot vote, but making change happen in our communities nonetheless. I know Grace and Yi have talked about the work that they're doing using film for organizing work and activism. And I think for me, I kind of like to frame that analysis also through a theory of change through which I do cultural organizing. I think for me, when we really are intentional in using stories and narrative in a collective format, we can make sure to use it strategically as part of cultural strategy. When we weave together the individual stories that people have and turn it into a constellation towards a cultural strategy. And these are frameworks through which I've learned, you know, from folks at Center for Cultural Power, you know, like Fabiana Rodriguez, you know, and other folks like Jeff Chang. And when we use our stories, individual stories, and put them together towards a cultural strategy, we can use those stories, you know, to make people feel something. When people feel something, often that's how we are able to agitate them. And when they're agitated, that's how we're able to mobilize and organize the community. And from there, you know, when we organize the community, that's how we're really able to see change happen in community, whether it's policy change, you know, electoral change by getting people to vote for new people in office, you know, or really seeing a bigger social transformation beyond the electoral and political frameworks. And I think if we think about the movement for Black Lives in particular, we kind of see this theory of change, you know, at work, you know, with the continuous, you know, killings of Black people by the police, you know, and terrorism that community members have been experiencing. You know, we got to really see those stories, you know, through the media. You know, often though the media does use very trauma porn kind of ways of telling those stories. But when those stories are told, you know, community was able to organize these last couple of months, you know, with the leadership of the Movement for Black Lives and other organizations across the country and around the world, right? And now we see how there's all these initiatives and political agendas to defund the police, right? And I think that kind of really highlights how this theory of change kind of takes effect in recent events. And for me as a filmmaker, I also use the model of work that I do as an impact producer. For me, having been an organizer before I was a filmmaker, I've been organizing since 2010, started in the Federal Dream Act work, you know, in the immigrant youth movement. We realized in movement work how we have campaigns, right? And for our campaigns, we develop content, whether it's film, whether it's artwork, whether it's media. And in the space of documentary filmmaking in particular, where I have been engaging for the last 5 years, you know, we create campaigns, impact campaigns for films. And the film serves as the bigger vehicle for campaigns. My experience also in when I was younger, as an undocumented person, media makers coming to my community, you know, wanting to tell our story, right? Because they feel that, you know, when they make this film, they're gonna change the world, right? And not really recognizing the organizing work that folks have been doing on the ground before they even thought of this film, right? So the work of the impact producer, you know, often in this realm is to really connect the filmmaker, the film, and connect it to the movement organizers on the ground so that the film can be used as a cultural tool for the organizing work that folks are doing. So these are kind of the inverse models that I've experienced as an organizer and as a filmmaker. And I think, you know, these days there's an aspiration where storytellers, filmmakers, artists are integrated in work around movement really and being thought of as strategists along with the campaign organizers, right? But also how artists can be more mindful and intentional when building community with organizers and making sure that the perspectives of organizers who have an ear on the ground with what's most effective in terms of making change happen, how artists can make sure to amplify that work. I'm yet to see this kind of model really in take effect, but I think this is the model of work that I really aspire to in the cultural organizing work that I've been doing. So I'm gonna share now a clip from coverage, as Grace mentioned in the introduction. This is a documentary, short documentary that we did in collaboration with the California Immigrant Policy Center and with the Health for All movement in California, highlighting the work of two undocumented organizers and leaders in the state of California, Hector Presencia Juarez, who is one of the founding leaders of the Health for All movement, and Emma, who is an undocumented caregiver and organizer, working with the Filipino Worker Center to really support caregivers across the country, and really highlighting how undocumented people who are considered essential workers across the country, you know, whether it's as, you know, home care workers, healthcare workers, organizers, how ironically undocumented people are excluded from access to the very care that they provide for other people. I'm gonna share my screen right now to share the video and make sure to share the audio also, sorry.
Ito yung pinaka-last na family picture ko. Picture ito ng isa kong apo. Yung pangalawa kong apo, hindi, wala pa akong picture noon. So ayan siya. Ito ang mini altar ko. Tapos alam mo naman, Kapag Pilipino talaga, meron tayong mga balikbayan box na pinapadala o binibili natin para padala natin sa mahal natin sa buhay. So ito, ready for shipment na to. So may mga bagong ano naman, may mga bagong pabili na naman.
Yung mga dokumente na nandito, may mga kwento yan sa buhay nila. Parang karapatan mo yan kung ayaw mong lumantad na undocumented ka. Sa akin naman is, hindi na ako natatakot. Isa lang ang buhay natin, so maski undocumented tayo, kailangan din nating mamuhay ng normal. Ano mangyayari sa atin kapag magkasakit tayo or debilitating na mga kondisyon na kailangan talaga magkaroon ng treatment? Wala tayong insurance, wala tayong pera. So, saan tayo pupunta? Lalo na sa mga immigrants, saan kami pupunta? Kaya na-open up na meron palang mga karapatan ng isang worker, merong karapatan ng isang babae, merong karapatan ng isang tao. Kung magsasalita lang ako na magsasalita, wala naman makikinig. Pero kapag isang grupo talaga na malaki ang grupo, naririnig siya, naririnig yung boses mo, kung marami kayo. So, iniisip ko talaga na isulong talaga yung magkaroon ng, you know, health insurance para sa lahat ng tao. Hindi lang para sa mga undocumented, lalo na sa mga seniors.
And I think for, as I close, I just want to share, you know, kind of like some of the data that we've been getting as we have our screenings across the country for coverage. We've had around 111 responses to our screenings as of April, and we've screened across the country and had a national screening also. We made a survey to kind of get an understanding of the impact of the film, right? And we asked folks three sets of questions, two of which I'm going to share here. We asked them, before the screening and the pandemic, healthcare for undocumented immigrants was an issue I advocated for or paid close attention to. And as you can see, the respondents were responding all over the map, right? One being disagree, five with being agree. And then we asked them the same question after the screening. As you can see, after the screening, folks shared that, you know, they are more aware of the issue of healthcare and undocumented immigration, and also being more intentional about advocating for this issue. And similarly, we asked them before the screening, I have been regularly involved in advocacy activism. Most folks, you know, were very much involved already. And we asked them the same question afterwards, and folks have shared that after the screening, they are more interested in being more involved in activism. And I think it really highlights how we can make sure to use storytelling as advocates, you know, beyond just the grassroots organizing that we're doing, how can we make sure to use filmmaking and storytelling as a vehicle for the work that we're doing. And I just want to close by saying that being undocumented myself, my experience with media is that often media about undocumented people is catered to audiences that are not undocumented. You know, Toni Morrison, you know, was once interviewed by Charlie Rose, and you know, he asked her, like, will you ever write about white people, you know? And Toni Morrison said, it's like our lives have no meaning without the white gaze. I think for undocumented people, sometimes it feels like our stories have no meaning unless it calls people to vote on our behalf, right? And I think we really need to reframe who we think about as audience for undocumented stories, and making sure that undocumented storytellers also have the tools needed to be able to tell our own stories about us, by us, and for us. Thank you. And now I'm going to pivot to KV. Thanks so much, everyone, for having me.
Wow. I almost cried about 5 times. So, my goodness, it's really hard to follow that. And thank you so much for inviting me on. I feel like what Grace said at the beginning, that anybody could be an organizer, is especially true for me, because I was very sleepy at the beginning of this process. My co-founder of Wake Up Atlanta, Thee Nguyen, who at the time was a lawyer, just said, hey, are you registered to vote? And I was not. But she knew that I had a big network of Asian American friends and family, not family, I guess, of Asian American friends. And so She just said, can you help me register some voters? At the time, I had just quit my job to go work at BuzzFeed in LA. And I'm like, I guess so. But you know, my main thing is just making like food videos. So I don't know what else you want from me. I'm down to like help you register some voters. And it started as just voter registration, two friends doing that. But we realized quickly that there were just so many questions. Maybe it's because we live in the American South. Maybe because Asian Americans don't get enough education on this. I know myself that I was naturalized when I was 18. So I think in civics class, I didn't think that any of that applied to me. And there are definitely not those conversations happening at home because we don't talk about politics. And so we realized that voter registration without voter education cannot work. And Asian Americans Advancing Justice, our fiscal agent, was doing so much already for voter registration. So we wanted to take that voter education piece. And after the 2016 elections, he said, we need to do something. You are a video maker. Are you gonna go to LA right now when you specifically are in the South for a reason? And there are many fights that we will fight in the South. You wanna be part of something bigger or wanna go make food videos? And so, yeah, I stopped. I didn't go make food videos. I stayed and we created Wake Up Atlanta. We got a grant and we focused on Asian American millennials because we are millennials and we wanted to change the culture and create a habit of voting among younger Asian Americans and make them lifelong voters so that we don't have to work before every election to get them to turn out. And our goal is to keep all of our episodes under 3 minutes. But as you know, talking about politics, you can't really do that. So that's our rough goal. And our another goal we have is to always keep it 60% information and 40% entertainment. Because if you do civic work, you know it's a lot of vegetables, but we gotta remember to give people some dessert. So our format is Women on the Street, which is us just literally going out to interview folks on the street. It started with the thinking that everybody just knows who the mayor is. And while we're writing the episode, like, I was like, Fee, I don't even know who our mayor is. And she said, of course people know who the mayor is. I'm like, you wanna bet? So I wanna show you our first clip. The bet.
Special guests along the way, Atlanta City Councilman Alex Juan. Thanks for joining us.
First question, can you name the Atlanta mayor?
No.
Can't remember it all.
Okay. Cool. No,
I cannot.
Can you name an Asian American elected official?
Oh, gee, you got me on that one.
City, state, national.
Can I say it? Okay.
Okay.
No.
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 Okay.
No.
Just so you know, I'm Alex Juan. I'm on the Atlanta City Council, so I'm I am an Asian elected official. So now you know one.
Oh, yeah.
So at that time, he was the only Asian American elected official in Atlanta. Now I think we have like three. So yay, progress. But we really love using the Women on the Street interviews as a way to introduce a new topic to our audience. And so this next clip is to show the absurdity of some of the bills that come about. And this one is highlighting the RAISE Act, which was a merit-based immigration system introduced by our very own David Perdue, our senator. It just shows the ridiculousness of the questions, and neither Fee nor I passed the test. So we just wanted to see if regular people could pass the test. So our clip number two, please.
The RAISE Act wants to assess people based on their merit, so how much you make or the education that you have.
How old are you?
I am 24.
30. Sorry to ask you that on camera.
56.
0 points.
Do you have a Nobel Prize?
Not right now.
But you're working on it.
Working on it. Maybe later.
No.
Maybe later today. Okay. We'll see.
Have you won an Olympic medal in the past 8 years when you were a child?
No. Can't swim fast, but I mean, I can get in there.
All right, that's still 0 points for being able to swim but not fast. Let's tally it up. You got 23 points, but you needed 30 to apply here.
That's going to take my citizenship away? What's going on?
But I want to go to America. What happens now? I need to be in America.
You win a Nobel Prize.
Wow.
So we add a lot of humor to it because it's kind of almost humorous that these bills exist, almost to the point of crying. We just did that one, and we do a lot of other women on the streets to raise awareness to certain elections coming up. And another format that we use is studio episodes where we explain something larger, like laws that have disproportionately impacted Asian Americans. And if you know anything about Georgia, you know there are a lot of those. I want to show you this one census one because we did a lot of work around elections, but our undocumented friends could never participate. And census is one way that everybody could participate. So we knew that we wanted to work around the census, and we've been working on the census for a year and a half. And this is a little snippet of our Census 101 explainer.
Of everyone in the country using this little thing called
census.
The census is a head count of every single person living in the United States every 10 years. And why does this matter to you?
Money.
That head count is how the government and businesses decide where to spend their money. Funding things like schools, hospitals, roads, public housing. The government is basically saying, yo, we're ordering pizza. How big is your party? And if we don't answer, we may only get 50 pizzas when we actually need 5,000.
It's just 8 questions, and to be clear, none of them are about your citizenship status.
Census workers will literally come to your door.
Which means you'll have to pause Queer Eye and talk to a stranger, and nobody wants that. And we have this video translated into 15 other languages, so you can send it to your auntie too.
So the reason I say we've been working on it for a year and a half is because we made that one pretty easily. You know, we both speak pretty all right English. But we realized that because our audience is millennial Asian Americans, they're not always the ones filling out the census. And so we added 15 other languages to our docket and organized with 15 communities to translate and be the talent, get a teleprompter, and make them feel like the stars of the show that they are. And one really incredible thing that came from it for me in the second I got this email, I just knew that what we were doing was so impactful. The second we sent it to the Burmese community and they put it on their Facebook, they got 60,000 views in 24 hours. And you know, it's not like cat videos on YouTube. It's nothing sexy. It's like literally explaining the census. And so I was so confused, and I emailed them and said, why, what'd you do? What is your secret sauce? And they said, we think it's because we never have anything in our language. And it just looks so professional. And everything that's in our language that's professional is from our country. And I don't know, I teared up and I was like, okay, let's keep working. I love the census. Our last one I wanna show you is a really quick TikTok that we made once all of our tour got stopped. We usually go to high schools and colleges to screen our episodes and just talk a little bit about the census. We had census postcards that they could send to folks, but our tour completely got kind of derailed from because of COVID. We started doing more online things and collaborating with artists and influencers. So this is one short TikTok challenge that we made.
Don't rush, slow touch, grind on white.
Like I go crunch, grab and buy. I can go bust, eye for eye. I can lose trust, white rum, fizzy pop. Where you they go, go, we they go up. Catch my vibe, let me go off. Blam the trash, man it's so tough.
Alright yo, put the belly on the body, make a clutch. Seen her watch, now she wanna give crutch. Boy got peas, now she hopping in the pod. Man a real life sugar gal, let my forget what. When she want dark, told her meet me at the top. Switching lanes the other day, I seen her waiting for a bus. Maybe this a Moncler sweater, diesel denim. Buy another woman.
Yeah, that was really fun to make, and we've made a lot of TikToks in these few months of quarantine. And that kind of ends my little session. Thank you, and happy to take any questions.
Thanks so much, KV. We do have a couple of questions, and I'm going to start with one for you, actually. This is Q&A, it's for all panelists. But from Mike, they said, hi, KV. Your series Wake Up Atlanta communicates civic engagement in a clear and accessible way. How can legislators, representatives, and grassroots organizations improve their communications with the public?
My first instinct is to say, don't hold on to the don't hold on too tightly to the traditions. Sometimes when we're looking up the stuff, there's just so much legal text that nobody understands. And just updating the vocab sometimes. One thing that we worked around was the transit. They called it the transit referendum. And it was like, yo, just call it MARTA expansion, because everybody knows MARTA, which is our train, and expansion, like everybody knows that word. But when we interviewed folks and we said, have you ever heard of the transit referendum and are you gonna vote? Folks were like, I literally don't know what that is. But then we literally 30 seconds later said, oh yeah, MARTA expansion. They're like, oh yeah, I want that. So I think just using really plain language and not feeling like we have to stick to certain words. If you explain it to your, you know, like 8-year-old nephew and they don't understand it, stop using those words. And also meeting people where they are, because I know that we just want people to care so much, but you know, it's all a journey. And if we scare folks away, then they turn away way harder than if we just kind of give them a little bit of dessert first.
Thank you so much. This next question is for Seth. What are some difficulties making films with undocumented individuals? How do you ensure their safety and minimize the risk that they may experience from your exposure?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think when working with undocumented folks, it's important, especially through nonfiction documentary storytelling, especially with folks, you know, that are in a little bit more of a vulnerable situation. I wanna make sure that it's a collaborative process where it's based on trust, you know, and another ADOC member, Ligaya Romero, always talks about filmmaking, especially documentary filmmaking, having also a consent culture, you know, and making sure that part of people wanting to tell their story is that they're trusting you and they're consenting to you working with them. And I think in every step of the way, when I'm working with undocumented folks, I also think about people in my life first that I want to work with, because, you know, we're already in community, instead of having this idea of like access, you know, like going into the wild, quote unquote, you know, and like looking for people that I don't know already. For me, because, you know, in the undocumented community that I'm part of, even there's a lot of stories, you know, that are so powerful that are often overlooked, and being able to work with folks and making sure that they're part of the process, they have autonomy over what's happening also, and making sure that it's not just me calling the shots, but making sure that, you know, we're working in tandem. Actually, for coverage, there were 3 people that were originally filmed, but, you know, originally they were like, yes, let's go ahead, you know, but in the 11th hour, they were checking in with their lawyer, and their lawyer was like, you can't really be in this because you're talking about your health condition. this thing called public charge just happened, you know, so I had to re-edit just like a couple weeks before we were about to have like a community premiere. You know, it was kind of stressful, not kind of, but it was really stressful, you know, but making sure that the community member was not jeopardized, you know, is part of our intention also. And as we do our impact screenings with different organizations, making sure that it's not just the filmmaker being highlighted, but also the organizers and the protagonists in the film.
Yeah, I feel like that answer really touches at a lot of, especially on consent culture and making sure that folks feel supported about sharing their story. That's really important. Thank you so much. This is from another attendee who said they love SET's framework for change and wanted to ask, how do documentaries have a different impact than fictional narratives?
Nobody wants to answer. I think, you know, it's really hard to measure impact on, I mean, everyone is very different on what they're going to take from a story. You know, you might be exposed to a fictional character who is based on, you know, reality that could sort of shift you, you know, looking at SET's framework that might, you know, change your perspective on or stretch how you feel about undocumented folks or Asian Americans or immigrants or whatever. Yeah, that's a really good question. I think those of us who do work in nonfiction, we, you know, think about our impact campaign. I think this is a, you know, something that we all are doing, working on, all of us on this panel. I can say for, and She Could Be Next, you know, we also have a big impact campaign leading up to not just 2020 elections, but beyond. And that is, you know, the key theme is there's an organizer in all of us, and how do you step into your power and how do you find your political home? I think you can be really concrete, because oftentimes films can partner with organizations who are doing the on the ground work. So for example, if you go to andshecouldbenext.com and go to the join the movement page, we have a map that's connected to the Movement Voter Project. You can click on any state and find a number of organizations, mostly, you know, people of color-led organizations who are doing the work in the community. So, you know, that's just a very specific way of how you can have an impact in nonfiction.
Hi, this is Carolyn. I just wanted to interject, but I asked permission. I asked Christine for permission to actually, on the other side of advocacy, not just advocating for a particular community to be able to engage and with your legislation and your political officials, but for filmmakers to also advocate for yourselves and as an art, as a profession that that is a job which gets paid, right? And so to think of things that way, and not just that you're also trying to channel other people's voices into a, you know, a narrative or a story, but also to advocate for your own product. So for example, with, you know, and I said, like, this is county structure, but we have 9-10 elected officials, you know, making meetings with them, as awkward as that is, but making meetings with them, sending them, you know, a screener, just like you would for the Oscars or, you know, a documentary award. The great thing about public office is that if it gets sent to you, their inbox or their mail, that someone has to read it or watch it. So that's even better, right? So, and if you send it to everybody, then they all got to do it, because if one does, then they all got to do it. So just this kind of advocacy, just because I think that is always missing when I'm on, when I watch panels on creative arts, especially in the Asian community, is that you're not advocating as your own profession, and that that takes its own support, and it can come from government, it can come from private sector, and it can come from foundations, but your local government, especially on the documentaries and the topics that you guys are highlighting, is very, very important. So just want to throw that in there.
That's why we organize as ADOC, right? In order to, we organize ourselves as filmmakers and, you know, support each other, provide resources. And, you know, I mean, now your agency can come to ADOC.org and find these resources and you know, pay us for using them.
Exactly.
So for first vote, it's been really great. I mean, documentaries, the characters are real people in real life doing real things, right? So I think, you know, for first vote, it's been really great to have Jennifer Ho and Kaiser Guo on the festival panels with me, and also for community screenings. And I, you know, honestly did not expect the film to be as relevant as it is now, with not just the election this year, but also with the pandemic, anti-Asian racism, and what's going on right now in the country. Having Jennifer Ho, who is an anti-racism educator, on the panel, it's been great to have her, because you know, audience have questions, you know, related to what's going on now. So I would say that's, you know, another thing about a documentary and having impact campaign and having your characters on the panel with you, you know, to talk about issues that are relevant now, relevant today.
If I could just add to Yi's point and the question around fiction, nonfiction, I think about this quote by this indigenous Maori scholar, Linda Tuhiwai Smith, in her book, Decolonizing Methodologies. She said something along the lines of, the remembering of a people relates not so much to the remembering of an idealized golden past, but rather a painful past, and importantly, people's responses to that pain. I think, you know, after the 2016 elections in particular, you know, like there's a lot of fear, you know, like there's these notions around like, you know, the hardships, you know, that our communities are going through. And I think with documentary storytelling, what's really powerful is that, you know, we have these documentation, like Grace's film, you know, and Yi's film, you know, like organizing that folks are doing right now, and how future generations who are going to experience things, you know, that are also challenging, can look to the moments that we're living in right now and have an understanding of how we in this moment are responding to the challenges as a community and organizing together. Because I think for me, when I look to documentaries, you know, and see movies from the past, you know, that really show people how they organize, it kind of serves as a source of inspiration. And I think for documentary filmmaking in particular, it provides a space for, you know, highlighting what's happening right now as a form of documentation that people, future generations, can look to.
Thanks. I think we have time for just one more question before closing. Really appreciate all of your thoughts. And this was actually one of our first questions, which is, when you're making a documentary and you're gathering stories and resources, how do you come up with the storyline for your film?
I mean, I can answer that. You know, oftentimes you don't know what the storyline is going to be. We didn't, when we were making And She Could Be Next, you know, we thought it was about this movement of women sort of transform, women of color transforming politics, but we did not, we thought it would be over on November, the election day, 2018, but then it turned into this whole other, as KB knows, dysfunctional, you know, voter suppression story in Georgia. And the whole part two is about voter suppression, which I wasn't expecting to be talking about that when we started out making the film. I mean, I think that's the beauty of documentaries, and also kind of the pain, because you don't really anticipate that, but it's what keeps it vital and keeps it exciting. And yeah, does anyone else have thoughts about that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely, I definitely echo that. It's kind of a big question. I mean, every step of the process, I guess. So I started out first vote, you know, trying to find characters specifically in battleground states. And I was looking for characters from both, you know, political sides. So the storyline really evolved after I find these four characters and what they're doing. And, you know, and it all kind of came together in the editing process. So I initially had, you know, to Grace's point, sometimes we don't even know, and it always evolves in terms of the storyline, because I initially had three characters, Kaiser, Lance, and Sue Gooch, and Jennifer Ho actually came a year after I started production, and she just became this really great character. And also, you know, the under her storyline really tied together everyone's story and the, you know, underlying theme of racial justice, Asian American identity. You know, on top of voting, it adds another layer of complexity. So, yeah, I mean, it really evolves throughout the process.
Yeah, I guess I'd like to add, not as a documentary filmmaker, but just as a maker, that we really can't write the story first before we're done listening. And for documentaries and any kind of video, we just have to go through that journey with them. Like our little video on whether people could name the mayor, we literally like had written out, okay, Asian Americans can't name the mayor. And then we're gonna interview people who aren't Asian American, and they're all gonna be able to name the mayor, and it's gonna be hilarious. And then it turns out nobody could name the mayor. So we're like, oh, okay, well, never mind. And we talked about it later. And we talked with the people who wrote our grant that, yeah, sometimes you just never know what's gonna come up. And I think the really great shows and documentaries are the ones who kind of follow that story and don't have to stick to a really, really set script or timeline arc.
Okay, well, thanks so much. Yeah, did anyone else want to weigh in or? Okay, thanks again. Yeah, I feel like when y'all are talking about how you like see how your story is evolving, you adapt to that, that's really responding to like actually what's out there. And with that, I wanted to our last like ongoing question that we've been receiving a lot is just, do we have access to these, like, how do we get back in touch with like these documentaries, finding these clips? And so I wanted to pass it over to Grace for closing comments and also on actually how to follow up with all of these creatives.
Great. Yeah, thank you everybody. And thanks everyone for participating in the workshop. I would like all the panelists to actually put in the chat how they can access you and also your films. And also, I think Renee has put in there also how to access ADOC, but it's aid-doc.org. I just wanna thank everybody for participating. We're gonna make a resource folder available for all attendees. So thanks. ADOC for doing that, organizing ourselves. Thanks everyone for joining us. I hope you can catch everyone's films through these resources. And I'm just gonna make another special plug for episode 2 of And She Could Be Next, which airs tonight. And you will actually see KV organizing her community in that film as well. So you might catch all of us. I hope to see you online. Thank you so much and see you out there. Thank you.